But in the mornings, I was getting up and praying really hard over my business, and God was blessing it, and I was passionate about it, and things were going really well. And then one morning, as I was praying for my business, the Lord convicted me. It was like, are you enjoying your relationship with your wife as much as you're enjoying what you're experiencing in business?
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, whether you've been married for 2 years or 20 years or maybe a little longer, like in our case, you're going to have disagreements from time to time with your spouse, and it comes with the territory. Now, I know some of you are going to say, I have never argued with my spouse. That's great. Consider it a blessing, and you don't need to send us a note. But most people will have, from time to time, some arguments. And it's crucial to recognize another factor in conflict. There's a spiritual war going on in your relationship. And that's actually a healthy place to realize what's going on. And in the American church, we tend to underemphasize the role of spiritual warfare. Scripture's clear, though. You have a real enemy who is working to undermine God's design. And that's for your life, your relationship, starting with your spouse. Ephesians 6:12 says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. It feels like it, but it goes on to say, but against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Our guest today will share the important reminder that a godly marriage is a target.
Yeah, we're all under attack at some level in our marriages. Just this morning, Jim, before I left, I looked at my wife. I said, I don't know where we went from happy to some conflict before I leave here, but I've got to leave. I'm on your team. And she looked at me and she said, it's not you, it's me. I'm just struggling right now. And I thought, oh, there is something bigger here, because I really don't want to be, you know, struggling against her. So I'm so glad we have Jason and Tori Benham.
It's intervention
here.
Time.
It is. Well, for all of us, right? We all need these reminders that there's something outside of us that wants to tear us apart.
Yes.
So Jason and Tori have been on the broadcast before. Jason with his twin brother, David. Today, a much better looking counterpart. And Tori.
Certainly.
You've been married for 20 years. They have four children. They have several businesses. And they've written a book about some of their journey. It's called Beauty in Battle: Winning in Marriage by Waging a War. And you can get your copy of that from us here at the ministry. Stop by focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 1-800, the letter A, and the word family.
Jason and Tori, welcome to Focus. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Good
Thank
to be here with
you
guys. Both.
Yes, we're so glad to be here.
It is good. And we alluded to it already, but why is it so important for couples to be aware of the spiritual battle going on? I mean, it's so easy to fall into the worldly stuff, right? She said what? You said what?
Yeah.
I mean, rather than going, okay, someone's stirring our hearts here in the wrong direction.
Yeah. You know, my dad always used to say that how you see the battle determines how you fight it.
Huh.
So, John, I look back at what you just said about you and your wife having a little disagreement this morning. And I think in that moment, what Satan wants more than anything is to get you fighting face-to-face against each other, rather than shoulder to shoulder against him, right? He wants you tied up in a personal battle rather than engaged together as teammates in a spiritual war. And we see this all throughout Scripture, especially there right at the beginning of Genesis. You know, when Satan was up in heaven and he was an angel, of course he was Lucifer then, he wanted God's authority. He wanted the throne. And what did God do? Yep. He obviously wasn't going to fight him. So he sent Michael the archangel to fight him, and they ended up getting into this scrummy, and sure enough, Satan loses and gets cast down to earth. And then God decides that he's going to make a man. And where did he put him? In the same spot that he just put his banished foe. Like, and then God didn't give Adam, as far as we know, any heads up that Satan was there. And God also didn't have Eve alongside him. He let Adam go on his own there and have to deal with taking dominion over the garden without his counterpart. And of course, we know why, because he wanted to make sure that Adam knew that he needed her. And then God gives Eve to Adam. And the whole time, though, Satan is watching this, and Satan has yet to pounce, because Satan wants that authority that Adam has. And sure enough, Eve comes along. God gives him the greatest gift that he could ever have, because he knows that Satan is about to attack. And so when you talk about, why is it important that couples understand that there's a spiritual war? When you know that the very first couple was placed in the context of a fight that Satan was going to pounce, and God said, you know what, I'm going to need to protect them against this, and I'm going to give Adam the greatest thing he could ever have, a spouse. And where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. And the gates of hell cannot prevail against the church. Marriage is the most organic form of church.
So, that's John, so true.
If you see your marriage as a church, now all of a sudden you and your wife, you're going to figure out a way to work through this conflict. Because
yeah,
you know,
it's
Satan
so
wants
good.
It.
And I love that illustration of, you know, that being a stench, that marriage is a stench in the nostrils of Satan.
Mm. Yes.
Because it is reminding him constantly that God made human beings, made man in his image, and he made them male and female, and the two shall become one.
Right.
And that very image is right in the face of Satan every day. I mean, that's why we need to fight for our marriages.
Yeah. Right.
And it makes you fight differently.
It does.
And I can attest to the fact that Gene and I have certainly seen it differently in that way. You had, let's get to it, because this isn't something, knowledge that you're born with. You kind of had to develop these thoughts. Mm-hmm. You had a long distance beginning. You were courting, but it was from a distance. Mm-hmm. And then you got married and you went on your honeymoon. So just wrap that into a ball for us. First courtship at a distance. How did that go?
Oh my goodness. Well, while we were courting, when we were dating, Jason was actually getting his master's degree in marriage and family counseling in the off season of playing with the Baltimore
Orioles.
Was
that attractive to you that he
was
doing this?
It was.
Was.
I was like, he said, well, we need to learn about marriage, so let's just do it this way. And so he began to he began to get his master's, and he starts sending me home all of his notes, and he's calling me, he's sending me the books, and we're like, oh my goodness, this is amazing. God is so good. He's setting us up, right?
Yeah.
And then we get married. He set us up all right.
So you go on this honeymoon that you planned, right, Jason?
I planned
it. And what happened? Knowing that you were meant for each other from the beginning of the world.
Yeah, exactly. We were so excited. We were thrilled. But yeah, Jason didn't tell me where we were going, so he told me to pack light. Well, he meant that we were going somewhere warm.
Light happened to be the most monstrous suitcase there was.
Oh, my goodness.
I didn't know where we were going, so I packed this big suitcase, and we get to the Bahamas, and we get onto the cruise ship, and immediately I'm seasick. I had never been on
a boat.
That's
not good for honeymoon time.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah, that's exactly
right. And so, you know, we very quickly realized that expectations were going to play a huge role in our relationship. And I had gone from this high of, you know, being a beautiful wife at my very best, you know, the week before, to being sick in bed, my very worst. And I just felt so hopeless. Like, this is not the way it was supposed to be. And of course, Jason felt the same way. And Jason ended up, he said, we were getting ready to go, and he was irritated, and he was not himself. I said, this is not the Jason I know.
And I think something about throwing a suitcase across the cabin on the ship.
Well, you know, I helped her pack. And then I was packing it, and she said, give it to me and I'll pack it. And I said, okay, fine. And I threw it across.
Slung it.
Are you kidding? I wasn't a good husband. I was a new husband. But disappointment is the gap between expectation and reality. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know that little lesson. And so we learned through the trial of fire that conflict is going to come. It's going to come fast. And you're going to be revealed for the junk that's inside you. And Satan's going to be laughing the whole time because he's going to be watching it. Because he wants you fighting face to face because he knows how dangerous you are fighting shoulder to shoulder.
Well, people hearing you got to say, okay, you're reading these books. You're getting your master's in counseling and marriage.
Right.
What happened, Jason?
Yeah, I mean,
you know, because it's a book knowledge, right? Mm-hmm. And now it's real.
Yes.
Yeah, it's like the people that don't have kids when they see the kids in the grocery store having their tantrum. You know, when I have children, my kids will never behave like that. And God kind of says, okay, we're going to put that over here for a little while.
You know, with my studies, I discovered that in any unhealthy relationship, it's typically tyranny by the most selfish person.
Hmm.
So whoever's most selfish in that moment, I happen to be the most selfish person in that moment. And so I literally became a tyrant. Mm-hmm. That's essentially what it became, where I controlled the situation and I wanted to control things. A lot of guys struggle with that.
One of the things that's so good, and you know, I think it is a process for young married people to learn, and it sounds like we've all learned this over time. Sometimes it takes some couples longer. Mm-hmm. But this idea that actually conflict, if it's handled well, it can improve your relationship. You learn about yourself, mm-hmm. and your spouse learns about him or herself.
Right.
But it has to be seen as growth opportunity. Yes. You know, it's kind of like that job performance review. Mm-hmm. Hey, you're doing all these things well. Let me give you a couple things to help you improve in some areas. And it's kind of like that, right? Where some areas that, you know, I'm not doing as well. Speak to that idea of learning through conflict.
Well, I think strength comes through strain. So, Jim, if you want muscles as big as John, you know, you're going to have to go get under that squat rack. You're going to have to go get under that bench press.
I only hope that I can get there.
But, you know, God purifies us in the context of conflict.
Yeah.
We're made for conflict. So Tori and I like to say, look, don't stop fighting. Start fighting the right way. Because, I mean, all of us at this table could easily say that marriage is under attack like never before.
Oh, the numbers prove it.
And Tori and I would say marriage was made for the attack.
Huh.
God wants it attacked, because as your marriage gets attacked and you experience that conflict, those who suffer together stay together.
Mm-hmm.
It increases your commitment level to each other.
Well, and your intimacy emotionally,
yeah.
Spiritually.
I mean, you look what happens to, you take 120 young men and you send them off to boot camp for 12 weeks and, you know, as Marines, and then you send them off to war and they come back a year later, a band of brothers. You know, it's like you've got the one ring that will always keep you guys bound together as a married couple is not your wedding ring. It's suffering. That when you move through that and recognize, you know what, this conflict is not going to tear us apart. Where John looks at his wife tonight and says, you know what, you're not my enemy. And she says to you, you're not my enemy. Satan is the enemy. We're going to defeat him together. He wants us fighting against each other because God has a plan for us to fight against him. And we're not going to let that happen right now.
So here's one of the things that couples struggle with. Typically, not always, typically opposites attract.
Mm-hmm.
Not in every space. You may both enjoy coffee. That's not what I'm talking about. But oftentimes, introvert, extrovert, because you're looking for the completer. Which is an awesome thing that God shares with us, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to create your completer, your helpmate.
That's good.
And it's interesting that we do tend to lean toward those things that we don't have, and that's what we're attracted to in a spouse.
Right.
But then you get together. I can remember Gene and I in our premarital counseling, we were like, oh, we are so much alike. That's why we're in the
we
deepest love.
Each love. Other.
We're so much alike. Then we got married and we're going, man, we are really different,
mm-hmm.
right? And I mean, one thing, she was not a morning person. She was a night owl and I was a morning person. I mean, I was in bed.
That was us.
I was 25, I went to bed at 10 o'clock.
Okay. Wow, you're a loser.
And yeah, I am, totally. But I am well rested.
There you go.
But Gene, like, she wouldn't talk to me before 10 a.m. I remember brushing my teeth next to her one morning, and she just wasn't talking to me. First year of marriage, and I'm going, are you mad at me? She goes, no, I just don't talk a lot before 10.
Mm-hmm. I can so relate.
And I had to figure that out. Yeah. I mean, I thought she was like sending me body language, like, you know, this isn't going so well.
Yeah.
She was just took her 4 hours to wake up.
Right.
This is Focus on the Family with Jim Daly. Our guests today are Jason and Tori Benham. We're talking about their book, Beauty in Battle, Winning in Marriage by Waging a War. We'll encourage you to get a copy of the book at our website. The link is in the program notes, or give us a call, 800, the letter A and the word family.
Tori, I want, I guess, to get your observation on this one. You mentioned in the book, Jason began traveling a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You had the young kids at home.
Yeah.
You were kind of going a little crazy.
Yeah, just a little.
Poor girl.
Like, and then he'd probably come home like I would and say, oh, you wouldn't believe who I met. The president, the senator, the whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right?
Note to self, don't mention the steak you eat.
Yeah, no kidding. Oh, the juiciest steak. It was the best restaurant ever. No, you got to come home with a little dour.
It was
you
awful.
Know, boy, it rained every day in New York.
Yeah, right. It was awful.
But speak to that. You know, that put you in a funk, really.
Yeah.
So help, you know, identify that with other spouses that are mostly at home, working in the home, you might say. How did that hit you, and then how did you resolve that conflict?
Yeah. Yeah, so when the kids were really little, Jason was traveling a lot, and he was gone quite a bit. And, you know, I had, my whole life, I had had a dream that I would work alongside my husband one day. And that was just always something that I thought we would be moving towards. And when Jason and David started their business and it kind of took them in a different direction, I was so busy at home raising kids and homeschooling that I didn't even really think about that dream for a while. I was just, my hands were full and we were busy. And so as Jason began to travel, I began to kind of pick up these bad habits of dealing with this pain in my heart of him doing a lot of life without me, things not being the way I thought that they were going to be, a lot of expectations that weren't really coming true. And so I, you know, life just was so busy that I just kind of felt like I just had to keep on going. But there was really this real deep longing in my heart to be doing more of life with Jason that I began to just feel really sad every time he left. And my way of dealing with it was, well, I've just got to get strong. Like, Jason's doing great without me, and I'm just like barely holding on without him. I've just got to figure out a way to get stronger. And the way that I did that was to kind of put up a wall between me and Jason, because I was trying to be strong on my own. And I knew that God was calling him to these different things that he was doing, and I didn't want to get into the way of that. And so I just began to build this wall as a coping mechanism for these just, you know, tough feelings that I was in, this sadness of him doing so much of life without me. And every time Jason would come home, I was just distant and I wouldn't really let him in. And
I'd have to win her heart back again.
During that time, I was learning about neuroscience and how our brains work and how our thoughts work and how, you know, our minds and our thoughts are really fascinating when you look into neuroscience and to see that our thoughts, they're like pathways. And the more that we think a thought, the more established these pathways in our mind become. So if I think a thought like, I've got to be strong, I got to do this life without Jason, and I begin to think he doesn't need me, and he, you know, he's totally fine without me, you need to become more independent, all these thoughts, right? But you started creating this pathway that I would go down every time he left. But what that was leading me to was not Jason. And I began to bring Jason into this and to say, you know, something's got to change. Like, I feel like I just want to distance myself from you to protect myself from the pain that I'm feeling in this season.
That's great that you were able to open up, though, and have that discussion, because again, that one-way road on your own would lead to disaster, probably an affair or, you know, just something.
Right.
And something unhealthy for your marriage.
Right.
And but that was really critical that you were able to pull together and say, okay, this is what I'm feeling.
Yeah.
I think this is why I'm feeling it.
Boy,
couples would be in such a better place if they could just be that open and that vulnerable.
Really, it stemmed from one day Jason was on the road, and out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And sure enough, he calls one day, and there's all this, you know, all this
excitement.
Yeah. and I just burst into tears, and he's like, "What's wrong?" And I lash out and I say, "I just don't think it was very nice." And as he said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "I just don't think it was very nice of God. I didn't even dream that big. I didn't have this grandiose dream. You know, I just wanted to do life with you. And it wasn't even really that much to ask. I feel like everyone should want this in their marriage. And I just don't think it was very nice of him."
So she had to renounce the lie that God was mean.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, and she walked through
this. If you
this.
Could have said that was the lie I was believing, I wouldn't. If I hadn't lashed out and said that, I would have never thought that I thought God was unkind. But God's like, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And that was in my heart. Like, I really began to believe, like, maybe God isn't really for me. Maybe he doesn't really hear me.
Well, and Tori, I so appreciate that vulnerability. Mm. I mean, that's amazing. And just your being in tune with the Spirit, even in valleys, to be able to say, okay, Lord, here's what I'm feeling. Mm-hmm. And what's so important for people to remember, and I would encourage people in this way, God can take your sorrows.
Yeah,
he wants to hear that from
us. Yes.
Sometimes we even try to hide that from the Lord. So we're kind of pretending in every direction with our spouse, with God. Better to lay it out there.
Yes.
And that's what's refreshing about what you did.
Yeah.
Jason, I'm not going to let you off the hook because, you know, you had some issues too as a husband, and you realized you had kind of allowed your marriage to become complacent.
Yes.
So I do want to hit that. And, you know, so wives are now going, that's good, Jim. Yeah, bring that out here too.
And God had to just smack me a good one. 5 years into marriage, here I am a husband. I would say on a scale of 1 to 10, I would rate our marriage, what would you say, Tori, 6 or 7?
Mm-hmm.
Which for most people, they'd say, great. We loved each other, we're best friends, you know, everything was great. But, you know, it wasn't everything that I always thought it would be. And I think most of us get to that point at some point in marriage. But in the mornings, I was getting up and praying really hard over my business, and God was blessing it, and I was passionate about it, and things were going really well. And then one morning, as I was praying for my business, the Lord convicted me. It was like, are you enjoying your relationship with your wife as much as you're enjoying what you're experiencing in business? Mm. And I had to be real honest. I was like, I don't think I am. And so then I began to pray, and the Lord was just reminding me of all those feelings I used to have for Tori before we got married. And I'm like, why is our marriage like hovering at a 7, which most people would say that is okay? Why can't it be a 10? Why can't it be an 11? Why can't it be just as awesome and hot and as romantic as it was, you know, as we thought it should be when we were dating? So I began to pray, and I would wake up every morning really early. Jim, you're an early morning guy.
Yeah.
And I would get right next to the bed next to Tori about 5:30 in the morning, and I would lay my hands on her. And I always made sure to keep it above the shoulder so she didn't think I was making an early morning move or anything. So I would pray that God would reignite my passion for her. And I did that every day for 2 weeks. And then Tori and I showed up at a party one evening 2 weeks later. And as typical, we walk into this party, you know, just like a little birthday party, bunch of friends there. I go one way, talk to the guys. She goes one way and talks to the girls. Only this time, after about 30 minutes, I was wondering where Tori was. I was a little more hyper-focused on her. And I walked around the house, and I finally found her in the kitchen. But I didn't. I saw her through a hallway into the kitchen, and she was talking to another guy. And this guy was standing awkwardly close to her, and instantly I kind of felt this little heat come up in my chest, and I just sat there. Now, I hadn't felt jealous in a while. I mean, I think there's a lot of guys out there that, you know, they've lost their jealousy, their protective jealousy for the apple of their eye, and you got to get that back. And so the Lord was about to give it to me, and so I saw them talking strangely close to each other, and then he busted a joke, and I'm sitting there watching this, getting madder and madder, and then to my horror, I saw him reach out and give her a hug, and she actually reciprocated and put her head down on his chest. And I have never felt anything like that. It was like somebody poured hot boiling lava on my chest. And then I woke up. It was a nightmare. Oh. And you know, your body doesn't know if it really happened or not. It was a nightmare.
This is a bad dream.
It was just a bad dream.
Wow.
I woke up but I had both of y'all, didn't I?
Yeah, well, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I love this. Okay, but it was a nightmare.
I was ready for the SmackDown.
And I woke up. Now listen, I was dripping sweat. I sat up in bed,
wow,
and I looked over at Tori, who was sleeping peacefully, having no idea that she was in love with another man. And I just knew that something was going on.
Yeah, that's a message.
Right? And I got up, and I was pacing around, and then I woke her up. I said, honey, you've got to tell me what's going on. I just had a dream that you were cheating on me. Of course, you know, the guy gave her a hug or whatever. And she's like, no, nothing. I promise. Calm down. I mean, it's okay. And I'm like, all right. So I went to the bathroom, washed my face off, and my heart rate started to slowly go down. And then I went over next to her bed, as I had for 2 weeks, and I started to pray for her again. And the Lord hit me. I gave you that dream because you have forgotten how to pursue your wife. And I want you to pursue her like that guy in your dream was pursuing her. And I remember saying, but how? You know, like when we're dating, we don't need a how-to manual on, you know, how to win the heart of our girl. Yeah. We figure it out. But how? And God took me to Revelation 2, where he was talking to the church of Ephesus. Mm-hmm. The church of Ephesus had a first love, and their love had grown cold. And God said, you need to do 3 specific things. When you look at Revelation 2, there's 3 things that popped out. He said, remember how far you've fallen, repent, and redo the things you did at first. Mm-hmm. Remember, repent, redo.
Mm.
God dropped that on me. Remember how much I used to think about Tori and all the stuff we used to do before we were married and dancing in the kitchen to country music. And country music is God's music. Dancing, all these things. Remember that. Repent for not doing it anymore. And redo the things that you did at first to win her heart. And I'm telling you what, for the next, I mean, ever since then, that was 5 years into marriage. We've been married almost 21 years now.
You know, it's a great reminder of how God uses the metaphor of marriage in our relationship to him, mm-hmm. him to us, us to one another.
Mm-hmm.
There is that strong indication about how he wants us to pursue him, us,
right.
one another in our
yes.
marriage. I mean, it is what he wants for us.
And we've got to remember, God's not just our father. He's our father-in-law. And what does the father-in-law want you to do? If you want to say, yeah, I love you to your father-in-law, what does your father-in-law then say
take
to you?
Take care of my daughter.
Take care of my daughter. Yeah. Take care of my son.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really good. This has been awesome. Man, what a great book, Beauty in Battle, and the idea that you're fighting together, not at each other.
Right.
And I so appreciate the thoughts and the many things we talked about today. And I hope if you're in that spot where you are not fighting together, you're fighting against each other, get a copy of this book. If you can send a gift of any amount, a monthly or one-time gift, we'll send it as our way of saying thank you for being part of the ministry. If you can't afford to do that, we're going to trust other people will cover that because we want to get it into your hands. We're a Christian ministry, so that's our goal. If you need it, call us and we'll get it to you. And there's also caring Christian counselors that you can contact here at Focus on the Family. Typically, they call you back because they got to put you in the queue, and they'll do that. But after over 40 years of ministry, you're not going to surprise us. I think we've heard it all. And you just need to be vulnerable. And if we can help, we want to help. So get in touch with us.
Get in touch today. Our website is focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 800, the letter A in the word family, 800-232-6459.
Jason and Tori, this again has been terrific. Thank you for just that openness, that vulnerability, and working hard to show that you are both created in the image of God and that the two shall become one. Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
We've enjoyed this. Thanks so much.
And thank you for joining us today for Focus on the Family. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team here, I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.